Welcome everybody, welcome at Triple. My name is Jeroen Sonneveld and today I will talk about how we use the BFF pattern in my Vodafone app. Let me introduce you Triple first. Triple is a digital agency that's developing apps for a lot of different companies in the Netherlands, such as Videoland, My Vodafone or Buienradar. Each app we develop with a different architecture, but one app is very special with that, and that's the My Vodafone app, because we developed it with the BFF pattern. I will talk today about that pattern. First, the table of contents. I will introduce you to My Vodafone app, then the purpose of the backend for frontend pattern, how we implement that pattern into the My Vodafone app, and I will close with things we've learned from using the pattern. So what's the My Vodafone app? Who of you already got the My Vodafone app on their device? Okay, quite a lot of people, nice. So the My Vodafone app is an app where subscribers of Vodafone can check their bills or see how much usage they have. When the user opens the app for the first time, it sees the dashboard. That's the first screen you see. And at that point, the user can select what option it would check. For example, the billing, that's the usage screen. That is the second screen you see. At that point, the user can see how much usage they have and how much usage they can spend till the end of the month. And on the third screen, you can see the bill screen. There's a lot of business logic in this for the My Vodafone app, but we decided to move that to the backend. So the app only should display the data, and that's done with the BFF pattern. So what's the purpose of the BFF pattern? Well, the first thing is that the backend decides what the frontend should display. So all logic is done in the backend, except the device logic, such as the usage of the camera or a live chat API. The complete view hierarchy is generated by the backend, which talks to backends internally, and sent to the frontend. And the app will display that with generic views that it contains. And because of this, most changes can be done in the backend. So it could be that no app update is needed because all changes are directly seen by the user with the same app. So how does this work? Well, we've got an iPhone, and the iPhone sends a request to the backend. The backend will think about what should I give back to the frontend. It will the backend for frontend will generate that view hierarchy and gets the data from, in this example, Vodafone backends. That could be multiple of them, and generates a hierarchy and send that back to the frontend. And the frontend displays that. So in this example, we've got a circle and three buttons that the backend generated. And the frontend just displays that elements. So that's nice, but what if the user clicks on a button? Well, the button already knows what its destination will be. So, for example, loading another generic screen, and what API call it should load on that page to get the data. So another screen will appear, a spinner will load, and then the data did come from the backend, the hierarchy, and displayed on the phone. So how did we do that in the My Vodafone app? Well, this is the usage screen, and on this screen there are five elements. First one is the tab bar, second thing is the usage items, a label, the notification, and a slider. The tab bar is used to select your subscriber. So if you have multiple subscribers, you can select the subscriber where you want to see the users from. The second thing is the usage items that are round balls where you can see how much users you have for each bundle. The third thing is just a simple label. Fourth thing is a notification, which Vodafone can use for marketing or give advice about what the user is seeing on that page. And last is a slider, which displays how many days still they will receive new usage. The backend has generated this view hierarchy and just sent that to the phone. And the phone contains these five elements, so it can display it. And a big benefit of this is that Android devices also only contains that views, and all the logic is done in the backend. So yeah, the phones only should display that views. So let's move on to just one view, how it's built. The code you see is JSON, and the type is a slider container, which is the name of the component. And with this, we know that we should show a slider. Then we have a min, a max, and a current value. And with that, we can build a slider. So we know where it should start, where it should end, and where with current we can display the point where it should be. And with right label, we can give a description to the slider. This is a very generic component at this moment, because we can also use it at the bundle screen, for example, to display to the user how many days left till the bundle will expire. So yeah, it's very generic. Okay, so how about navigation in the app? Because as I said before, you can press a button and the button already knows what the destination will be. Well, it knows it from the JSON that it received before, which contains a destination object. And in that destination object, there's an API object. And that contains a path and an object. The object in this example is a detail view. From that, we know what page we should load next, because that's a detail view. And when we are on the detail view, we know that we should load the path, and that is on this example the bundle/travel URL. So when the user press, for example, on the bundles for the price, which means bundles for traveling, the next page will load. We get the data and display that to the user. There are not only situations in navigation where a backend call is needed. For example, when you want to change your profile avatar, your profile image. And for that case, we are using use cases. They are in a destination, there's an object called use cases, and they have a type, and this example is change avatar. When the app receives that, we know that we should load the screen where the user can change his avatar. And because there's no API call needed, we just load that change avatar screen. So when the user press the profile photo aanpassen button, we instantly go to the next screen where you can change your profile picture. In the My Vodafone app, we have a lot of situations like this. For example, for live chatting and changing your avatar. And we have around 25 to 30 use cases in the app to manage destinations like this. So the app should load fast for the user. So we do some improvements, like already knowing what destination it should load when the user presses a button. But we also put all the images the app uses already in the app bundle. So from the backend, if we want to display an image, we just receive the image name. And because that app name of the image name is already in the bundle, we can instantly load the image. There are also situations where we can load images from the server. So if image name starts with HTTP, we can load it from the server and display that. But this will make it very fast because you can see it instantly. So what did we learn from using this pattern? Well, the first thing is that new developers in a team have a big learning curve on this. It's not only that the architecture is a bit strange at the first time, but also that there are a lot of generic names in the project, generic views, use cases, that you don't know what it is and what it does. And because there are generic names, it's hard to understand what's doing. The second thing is a benefit, in my opinion. It's that the developer is forced to make the view very generic because the backend can load the view on different places. You're forced to make the generic that the backend is able to use it on different places. So, yeah, it's a big benefit in my opinion. And the last thing is that updating states across view controllers is very tricky. The problem is that when you press a button, you load a new generic view, but that generic views don't know much from each other. So in this example, in the bundles flow, a user can, at the first screen, see the categories of the bundle, then they can select the bundle, read the information, and see the finish screen. And when the user pressed the OK button, you should go back to the first screen. But we don't know how many screens we should go back. So it's hard for the app to know how to go back. In this situation, we could add an action on the OK button to dismiss three pages. But there's also a situation where we don't use the third screen and just instantly go from the second screen to the fourth screen. And dismissing three pages is very hard then, because it won't work. So we made a solution for this, and that is giving the first screen an ID. And when the user pressed the OK button, we just dismiss all pages until we had page 532 for this example. So updating the views. In this example, also when you press the OK button at the top of the screen, there should be a bundle visible to the user that it just activated. So that's also that need to be updated. So that's hard. Last, that what we learned from building the My Vodafone app is that we moved much more business logic to the backend than we did before. So maybe when you're home, check your projects, and maybe you can move also a lot of business logic to your backend. Thank you. This was it. Are there any questions? Yes.
Does this have any cost in terms of debugging crashes when you're sort of able to instantly change your user interface to basically whatever you want, and you get a crash and there's a stack trace and you're just like, wait, what did this even look like when it was presented to the user?
Yeah, well, the few controllers we use, they are just Swift, so we can see which lines the crash will be. And the generic views, if there's a crash on a generic view, we just see which view it is, so we can fix that bug. So the crash reporters are just like normal. There's no difference between that. So, yes?
How does it work with compatibility? So, for example, you create a new container which is not available yet in the latest version, because it's new in the newest version. Would you skip that page, hide that button for certain app versions or something?
Yeah, in the backend, we send an app version to the backend, and the app of the backend just can display that to the user when it's on that version. So that's how to manage that. Yes, oh, sorry.
Now you explained about the dismissing, but I was thinking about, navigation sort of pushing back and then going, because I like to, go back and then go back again and, you know, play with the thing.
Yeah.
So would it work just to be dismissing screens, or is there another
way? Yeah, dismissing is just like normal. You just you
so it's the back will just, you know.
Yeah, back button just like works like normal because you are just in that navigation view controller. And you can just present or push a few controllers, but it's hard to go from fourth screen to the first screen because you don't know how many screens you should go back. But just dismissing one page, sorry?
Sorry, why pop two controllers then doesn't work?
Because it are just generic views that are next to each other and not popped up.
But then not in one navigation.
Basically,
the
question, but there is no view stack actually.
Well, it is, but because that it are a lot of generic pages. For example, we only could solve this because we give an ID, so we know that that page is unique, and we came back to that page. But otherwise, you don't know which page of all the generic pages in your stack is that page you want to go back to. So, that's the problem. Yes?
Is writing the business logic handled entirely by backend developers, or is there any point at which the app developers work with the backend to help write some logic?
The first time we sit together and talk about how it should work and what logic needs to be done, and then the backend just do that work. So first we sit together and the backend just do that work.
What's your backend written in?
Sorry,
the? What language is your backend written in?
PHP. PHP. Yeah?
More follow-up questions. Have you thought about potentially adding like a Swift facade on top of that so that Swift devotes the people who are working as iOS developers have something that they can work on that basically feeds off of the back end.
Yeah, but there are also an Android app, so.
Right, but the Android app could talk to the Swift.
Could be, yeah. Yeah.
If they want to use Swift.
Yeah, but you can imagine that if there's a lot of business logic in that back end, it's not easy to move that to a new back end or anything else, so. Yeah. Yes?
It was an existing back end?
Vodafone has a lot of backends, and the backend for frontend just talks to that backends, and that generates the view we should display. So there are a lot of different backends at Vodafone, and we make use of them. Yes?
Is there an estimate how much you gain by sharing the business logic between the Android and the iOS, and just having the view layer on each platform? So is it like instead of developing it twice, it's now developed just once?
Yeah. And
how much did it gain in development time?
I don't know how much. That,
okay.
Yeah. Yes? Yeah? Oh, sorry.
Sorry. Yeah? But what was the main purpose? What was the main goal of it? A/B testing or making it flexible?
Well, because. Yeah, it's because there's a lot of business data that we would like to have in one place. So we decided to move that to the backend to have it on one place and yeah, make the app just let it display. So that's the reason why we did this. Yes.
Do you have some views of like interaction for users and how it works. For example, I don't know, when you click on something, you collapse, so clicking on one button will change color on another view. We have something like this, and yes, how you describe it in JSON?
For device logic, we use just view controllers like you normally do. So we use a use case to navigate to that view controller, and then it's just in the app with all the logic that it needs. Yeah.
I mean, if you want to change something from the same controller, for example, you click on some button,
yeah,
the button, and the button of the view controller and want to change, you know, color and some view on the front as a top of the controller. You have some connection between these two views.
Yeah, if you want to change colors, you can use a delegate or anything else.
I mean, it's you describe it in JSON. Okay.
If you want to build a generic page with the content you want, you also can add colors, but...
Yeah, I mean, how you describe communication between two views, two generic views,
yeah,
was provided from backend in the same JSON.
Yeah.
Backend
returns. Per view, the backend returns.
Yeah, but for example, backend returns one view that displays something and the second view that has button, and we want to click on this button to change something from the first view.
Like he had with bundles, so, right? You activate a bundle. Make,
yeah, and then and you go back. Yeah, then you know you have to refresh.
How
yeah.
do you know on the first one that you need to refresh there?
Because in that function that you're dismissing the view controllers, you can also add that functionality to refresh that page where you are. Yes.
Do you have your own solution for mapping JSON DOM to native components or some existing components?
We just make objects in the app in Swift and put that in the objects.
Why not React Native?
I don't know, it's just native now. But yeah.
I guess the answer to that is that 3 or 4 years ago when we started with this, React Native wasn't really.
Practical solution.
Yeah.
I think Spotify has some kind of similar solution
that's
got native components as well.
Okay. Good to know. Interesting.
Fundad itself.
Yeah?
Fundad using the same
principle. Hmm. Interesting.
And
yeah.
I have a question about layout. How would you describe so on screens that you show every view one by one, like back view?
Yeah.
And how describe layout if you want. So if you create generic JSON for iOS and Android, you cannot use constraints because Android or the
well, the view is built in the app itself. So we just get data, for example, a current, a min and a max value in the slider. And that data we read as an object in the slider and set it with all Swift constraints and so that view is built in the app, just in Swift. And in Android, it's developed in Java.
So you can display on the stack view?
Yeah, it's in the stack view, yeah.
Okay.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you.